difficulty, but here we are. And I'm just checking on my phone actually to make sure that we are live. Making sure. Yep, there we are. We are.
Oh,
there.
Okay. Awesome. Awesome.
Yeah. So, thank you for everybody for joining us. I have a very special guest with us today, all the way from Kuala Lumpur. She's a very dear friend of mine and just an absolutely amazing businesswoman, amazing human being. the work she does is absolutely amazing. And she is just a business phenomenon. She's just absolutely incredible. So, I will let you introduce yourself, Murshida. I'm so pleased and grateful to have us or to have you with us here today. And I know it's morning there. It's what, 10 a.m. there?
It's 10:15.
10 a.m. Okay, 10:15. Yeah. And I'm on the west coast of Canada, so it's about 7:15 here. So I will let you go ahead and introduce yourself. And then we are so excited to hear about the law of giving and how it's going to help us grow our business. So very intrigued by that. And maybe, just maybe you'll tell us that story about how you went from, was it 5 cents to...
Yeah, it's actually 2 ringgit, so that's about 50 cents.
50 cents to what was it, 5,000 in 2 weeks?
5,000 in less than 2 weeks,
About
a week and a half.
Absolutely amazing. So maybe if we have time, you'll be able to let us in on that story.
I will.
I think it will inspire a lot of people. So
thank you.
All right. Well, I will let you go for it here. Thank you, Murshida.
Thank you so much, Holly. Thanks for having me. It's a real honor and a privilege to be speaking to Holly's group right now, because I know all of you are people who are spiritual, heart-centered, good people as well, who want to do good things through their business and through their work. So why I wanted to talk about this law of giving, because I feel that in business, ever so often, people don't talk much about this law of giving. They talk about the law of scarcity. I was just talking about this yesterday. competitive, being competitive. And it's like when someone has more, you get less and all that. That is so, I would say 1980s, it's gone already. It's somewhere where we are now in a very, at the age of spirituality, the spiritual awareness is higher. And the law of giving needs more acknowledgement. And I've activated this, I've realized this. I'm not that person who used to be very giving and doing charity work. I was very money, very much focused in all of those. yes. I know. Looking back at myself, I'm like, wow, it's amazing how life has led me to where I am right now. And I was very worldly as well, but something happened, like Holly said just now, back in 2006, where there was a lot of realization when everything was taken away from me. I had my business was down. And that time I was deeply affected by SARS. If you remember SARS, it's similar
to now. Yeah,
it is similar to now. So I'm more prepared now, and I'm like more at peace with everything that's going on
round
now.
But two.
ready for round two. It's like let's give it to me. That's right. And at that time, I was like, I was like not used to suddenly all my businesses, was affected. I had offices in Kuala Lumpur and in Singapore. I had staff in both countries, and I had to let go all of them. And I was 150,000 in debt. And at that time, my whole reality was shaken. I was like, I did everything right. I went to business school. I applied everything. And what happened? Why didn't it work? Until when I came to Kuala Lumpur in 2006, when my husband got a job, and we all moved our stuff there, and he wasn't paid, and he was fired, he was fired, and then
had SARS, you had to move to a new city. And your husband thought he had a job, but he lost it. So you're in this new city with the whole SARS thing going on, and nobody's got. You've got your business, obviously, but you're $150,000 in debt, and your husband's just lost his job.
His job, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
And when I checked my wallet at that time, that was when I saw I had 2 ringgit. Like that 50 cents?
$0.50 US. US. So that's like, US, yeah. That's like 30 cents Canadian or like 25 cents Canadian. Oh yeah. My gosh. And actually, I just want to say hi. We have so many people joining. I'm going to just
take a
moment and acknowledge them, and then we'll get on. I'm keeping them in suspense at the same time. Sure. So we have, hi, Carlene. Hi, Chandra. Hello, Elizabeth. Nice to see you. Gina, Marina, and Shade is watching. And Selma, hello. And I think there might be a couple more. And there's Sherry has just joined. Thank you so much for joining us, everyone. So I will let you continue on, Murshida. I'm sorry. I'm very excited to hear how the story is going to go.
Welcome, welcome, everybody. I'm just going to share with you the backstory of how this law of giving awareness, I received this law of giving awareness. Okay, so at that time, when I moved to Kuala Lumpur, my husband's job came with housing, temporary housing. It was a simple house, you know, and it's a catering company. Sorry?
This just gets worse and worse.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. So when we moved there, and then he was fired, and then he wasn't paid, and then but the boss said, "Oh, you can stay in the house for another 2 weeks, but I need the house back after 2 weeks," you know. So so I was like, "Oh my god, I checked my wallet, I've got 2 ringgit, which is like 50 US cents, and then I was like, "What am I gonna do?" So a few things came up in my mind at that time: run away, go back to Singapore, and go back with my baby. At that time, I had a 6-month-old baby. I was like, "Should I just go back to my family and say, oh, it's not gonna work, this marriage and everything, this everything's not gonna work," you know? That came first in my mind, and then when I look at both Zil and Munira, my daughter and my husband, and I said, "You know, I'm gonna keep this family together," you know. And that was when I realized the importance of the why, the big why, and very important, because then you will go for whatever it takes, because something else is at stake, something bigger is at stake. So I found them. They became my why at that time, and then I said, "Okay, what can I do?" Right. So I had no idea. I had no business. I didn't know what to do. I already lost contact with a lot of my clients, like from 2 years ago when I closed my business. And then after that, I went to the house. Right. So the boss said, "You have 2 weeks to stay in the house. After that, you have to leave." So that again was like a deadline. You know, when you have a deadline. Then suddenly things start.
Yeah, so a why and a deadline.
And a deadline, yeah. Before that, I didn't have a deadline. I was 150,000 in debt. But 2 years, I was broke, moaning, and being depressed. And, you know, there was no reason. You know, I was staying at my parents' house. And, you know, it was just didn't, you know, there was no big urgency. So when there's a deadline, that was when I started to think, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? And then I went to the house, the house that we were staying in temporarily, and I went to the storeroom. And then when I look at the storeroom, I went around looking, what do they have in this house? And I saw in the storeroom, I saw like 3-in-1 coffee, you know, Nescafe 3-in-1 coffee, and packets of crackers. And I was like, wow, suddenly gratitude starts seeping in. I became so happy, there's food, you know? So I'm like, yeah, there's food, I won't go hungry. And then from after that, I was like, what can I do? I opened my laptop, and it was an old Texas Instrument laptop at that time. And then this came out, this database, Malaysian CEOs in Kuala Lumpur. And I'm like, it was right at the desktop. And I don't remember keying in that database. And then when I opened it, there was like 300 over names in that database. And I was like, wow, where did this come in? So it probably came in like, you know, my last staff keyed in. So I saw the name of the CEOs in Kuala Lumpur and the email addresses. So I started sending out those emails, and I didn't ask for a job. All I did was I wanted to touch base with the people. I said, "Hello, I'm in Kuala Lumpur. I would love to meet up with you to see how, you know, we could possibly add value to one another." That was it. No asking for jobs, no asking for anything. And then after that, one CEO messaged me on the same day. And this CEO is the owner of Napoleon Hill Associates in Kuala Lumpur. She publishes all the Think and Grow Rich books, right? Oh, wow. And she said, "Come to my office the next morning, 9 o'clock. So I was like, wow, okay. So I went to the office the next morning. My husband sent me there.
How did you get connected with her?
Email. It was just email. You know, I found this email, like 300 over emails of CEOs in Kuala Lumpur.
You sent her an email.
Yeah, I sent all of them an email. And nobody replied except her, that one lady. So I met up with her. And when I met up with her, I didn't ask her for any job. All I did was ask her, please tell me a lot about yourself. You know, and that was when I first started noticing about when I put other people as importance. I didn't go there and say like, I have a, you know, I'm in Kuala Lumpur, I need a job, I only have RM2, blah, blah, blah. I didn't do that at all. I was there as professional. I dressed up well. I was carrying a baby. She was surprised I was carrying a baby to the office.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And then, yeah, it was like, wow. And my daughter was crawling all over the place at that time. And then after that, I asked her that question, you know, like, tell me a little bit about your business. And she got so excited talking about Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich, what your mind can do and everything. And then I asked her this last question. How can I help you? Is there anything that you need that I can help you in your business? Mm-hmm. And she said, yeah, I need more trainers. If you know anybody who would like to be a certified trainer, it's only RM4,000. And, you know, you get the whole package, but it's an online course. You know, there's no teacher. You have to do it on your own. You have to sit for the exams. You have to take videos on your own and all that. So she said, it's so difficult to sell. Malaysians don't really like to buy online classes back in 2006, right? So after that, I said, okay, if she can't sell to Malaysians, perhaps I can see what do I already have, you know, that I can help her. And at that time, I was not thinking of asking for a job. I didn't even ask her for commission. All I did was like, I wanted to just be more visible, you know, just let her like me. So I thought of how I can help this lady. And I started to message all of my Singapore contacts. And that was the time when I realized that, you know, what do I already have that somebody needs that would be of value? And I didn't need all of this insurance agents in my phone. I knew them as friends. You know, they're all starting businesses, having agencies. I didn't need to sell anything to them, but they might want to become a trainer. So I messaged all of those Singaporeans, insurance agents, to see who wants to become a trainer. You get certification. It's only RM4,000. Nobody replied. And that same day, in the afternoon, one person replied me and said, Mushida, is it RM4,000 or is it RM4,000? And then I said, no, it's RM. And she was like, wow, so cheap. And she transferred the money on the same day. And I was like, wow, I've got RM4,000 in my bank account overnight. And I mean, just by making calls. And with that 4,000, I went back to the Napoleon Hill office and I gave it to her. I said, look, you got a sale. My friend wanted to buy your trainer product, the Science of Success product, you know. Mm-hmm. And then she was like, wow, 9 o'clock in the morning, I met you. 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you got a sale. She was so impressed.
So you did that all in one day?
One day.
And you didn't at any time ask anyone for anything. You just offered your help, mm-hmm. which is, that is amazing, because being in the situation that you were in, I think a lot of people would be feeling really desperate and just wanting to, you know, get something, get some business, get, you know, someone interested in what they're doing. But you really turned things around and you offered and you asked, you know, how can I help you? That's amazing. Because,
I got a sale. And then she gave me RM1,000 as a commission, which I didn't ask for. And I'm just like, wow, I got cash in my hand, you know. That was my first 1,000 within about 1 day, about 2 days, the second day when I was in Kuala Lumpur. And with that RM1,000, I rewarded myself with a nice plate of spicy fried oily noodles. So rewards are so important. So I rewarded myself with spicy oily noodles. And then I did the same thing the next couple of days. I connected with people. I asked them, how can I help you? Because what I realized, being a business owner in the past, I knew how it felt like when people go to your office and just ask for a sale. You got to buy this. I want to sell this. I'm here to sell this. And I didn't like that feeling. Mm-hmm. So I made sure I was not in that position where I will be kicked out of the office, you know. So that was when I turned the conversation around by asking more questions from the person that I'm seeing. You know, I didn't tell anything about myself. She didn't know I was broke until much later. And she was like, wow, she was amazed by the story. She didn't know that I only had like 50 cents in my wallet at that time, you know. So that was the whole thing. And then I did the same thing over the next 2 days while I was in Kuala Lumpur, calling people, making contacts, making connections. Nobody replied. And then the insurance agent from Singapore called me and said, wow, I got the Napoleon Hill package. It's like really worth it. All the DVDs are there. The books are there. So she called me to say thank you. Thank you for referring the whole learning package for her. And I asked her that same question. What do you need? Is there anything I can help you with? You know? And I realized that is a magic question. And she told me, Mushida, you're in Kuala Lumpur. Do you know any of these rich people like the Datuks and the Datins? You know, Datuks and Datins are like the sirs and lords and, you know, ladies in England, the title, the royal. Yeah. So and I was like, and she said, you know, people who can afford my packages, because she sells investment packages, she said they're all the high-end people. Minimum at least $1 million turnover minimum, she said, in their business or incomes, that kind of customer she was looking for. So I told her, yeah, why don't you meet the Napoleon Hill CEO? Because I know her, right? So I hooked them up immediately. She flew to Kuala Lumpur. They had a meeting. I didn't understand a word. They were speaking in Chinese. After the meeting, the insurance agent told me, Mushida, thank you so much. You've really helped me, like, match with the right person, and the CEO was interested and she wanted to buy. So my friend, the insurance agent from Singapore, asked me, can I pass you your commission up front? It is a very big commission. I know I can close the sale, but I want to give you your commission up front. And I was like, wow, got commission. So I thought it's like additional $100 or $200. I'll be so happy.
Yeah.
I didn't check my bank account. The next morning, when I checked my bank account, I saw 20,000 ringgit in my wallet. And that's like 5,000 US.
5,000 you know? US dollars.
In my account, yes.
And this is like day three or something of...
No, it's about within the week. Because,
within a week.
Because after that, I was still following up, calling people. But that is how my influence grew in Kuala Lumpur. That's how people started to know me.
And all from that one magic question. What was that magic question again?
How can I help you? What do you need? Yeah, what do you need? Maybe I can, yeah, what do you need in your business? What do you need to grow in your business? What do you need to survive? What do you need? You know, these are the questions I always ask. What do you need to get you out of your problem? So it makes a person think of solutions, and it also makes them be very specific on what exactly they need to go on to the next step. And this is what I tried and tested in my business the last 10 years, that this is actually activating the law of giving. And when I study about this law of giving, it is about the more you give, the more you receive, right?
Using it before you realized what it was.
I did not realize I was activating gratitude. I did not realize I was activating law of giving. I did not realize I was activating the law of receiving as well. Because when there's energy blocks in all of this, like you're not grateful. I was stuck. The first gratitude I felt was when I saw packets of 3-in-1 coffee and crackers in my house, right? So that was when I totally shifted out of the poor me feeling. I was like, coffee.
So instead of saying, oh my God, all we have is coffee, 3-in-1 coffee, whatever that is, and crackers, yes. You're like, oh my God, we have coffee and crackers. Yes. And you just, the tone was different. The energy was different. You were showing up different. Oh,
yes.
Very interesting.
Gratitude.
More people have joined. I'm just going to welcome everybody for joining us. Sherry and Laura and Leslie and Katya and Kathy and Aura and Victoria.
Hello.
And there's one more name in Turkish. I'm so sorry. I don't know how to pronounce Turkish, but we're so pleased you joined us. Welcome, everybody, for joining.
Welcome.
And we are talking about activating the law of giving and how Rashida accidentally did it without even realizing it and had some really, really incredible success in her business. And at a time that was very similar to now, but even worse for her, maybe, than some of us have. She had SARS, she just moved to a new city, she had a new baby, and her husband just lost her job. So she looked in the cupboard and instead of looking at the crackers that were there and started crying. She looked at them and said, oh, I'm grateful we've got something to eat for the next while. And then she got out there and started working her business. So I'll let you pick it back up there, Marshita.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, thinking back at that time, it was not as happy as how I feel right now, you know, talking about it. But at that time, it was just these small emotions of bouts of happiness. But what I realized, the good things started coming in was those bouts of happiness, the bouts of gratitude that I get, mm-hmm. actually got me new things. Yeah. So gratitude, my why, being in a high vibe, and asking questions, thinking how I can help a person. And what did I have at that time? I didn't have money, but I had a whole lot of 300 over database of CEOs in Malaysia that would be of value to somebody. I didn't need them. I didn't know what I could do with them, you know, but I met one. And then after that, by using this database that I started connecting people with, and they liked it, you know, it's not like I sold things that they didn't want. I asked for permission and they liked it. Giving people what they want and what they needed, I was actually helping them. Yeah. And how that brought me to what I'm doing right now, doing social enterprise, doing humanitarian projects, is I realized that, you know, the more that we give, something else, blessings will come in many different forms. And okay, I'm gonna be very open with your group, sure. Holly. Yeah, at that time also, I was also facing a lot of challenges in my marriage, you know, because you know, all the stress and everything. So we were going through a lot of challenges, and I was thinking a lot about, you know, should I continue with this marriage? Should I keep it together? Yeah, the why was strong, but you know, there was nothing much that, you know, I felt like it was a happy marriage to me at that time. And then one incident happened. My husband's sister, who's a doctor, she called and she said she's volunteering at this orphanage. She says, you know, her hospital delivers a lot of babies. She delivers a lot of babies. But the next day, sometimes the mothers disappear, you know, and the baby is there at the hospital. So the babies are left at the orphanage just next to the hospital. So she said, would you like to help me? Well, I check up on the babies. Would you like to help me feed them? And I said, okay, yeah, sure. You know, so I, you know, we all three of us, my daughter, my husband, myself, we went to the hospital, went to the orphanage. And then I saw a whole string of whole beds, you know, all these lineup of beds, newborn babies with no parents at the orphanage, all abandoned from different places. And then that was when a whole mindset shift happened. And I said, why am I thinking so small about all these little things that's going on with, you know, that was not such big problem. It was like not mm-hmm. nothing major in my marriage. You know, it's just that, you know, that kind of feeling. Oh, my niece, I don't want him to be like this, that kind of thing. And I felt like this is so small. And looking that, like, all of us came together, even my daughter, she was a toddler at that time and she was playing with the other toddlers. You know, I felt like this is what I wanted to do. And my family was like, my husband was such a giving person. He was like crying on the side, looking at all these babies. Aww. And that kept our marriage and our family closer together. And I noticed the more we didn't go shopping like weekend, like people go to the malls, hang out at the malls much, because we were saving our money a lot at that time, you know. So instead, every weekend we go to the orphanage, we do something that we can help others. And what I realized during those times when we visit the orphanage, feeding the poor, feeding the homeless as a family project, our family got together, we got closer together, there was more love and happiness and joy in our lives. And that's why that was when I realized, when we all come in together and give, you know, something else, our family got closer, you know, my marriage got better.
So the power of giving, you know, it doesn't just work in business. It yeah. worked really well for you in business and still does, but also in our personal relationships.
Exactly.
So rather than actually focusing on, you know, the fact that there's no money in our bank account in that moment, or that there's some virus going on around us, really focusing on what can I give? And asking that question of people and putting it out yes. there is healing and very yes. powerful. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that very personal personal story. This is a private group, so it won't go out to our
people. Yeah. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, yeah. So this is what I highly encourage, you know, the law of giving is more powerful than you think. And that's why right now I incorporate this law of giving into my business model, where every money that I receive, every work that I receive, it also contributes to the training of a refugee or the homeless or a low-income family to come out of poverty. And I found the power of communities, like what you're building here, Holly, is amazing. You know, it's a community of people with a purpose. And I found that the power of community, when you can transform a certain community, that's where poverty comes out. That's where, you know, a lot of anger, hatred also leaves, because that the energy within that community really works. Yeah. So I incorporate that as in, you know, like a one help, one model. Every training, every business that comes in actually contributes the same mindset, skill set, training that can elevate another low income to come out of poverty. And with that, my business actually grew. We tried and tested this. We've been told by some business gurus, oh, charity is charity, business is business. You can't do this. You know, you've got to grow your profits. Then you set a percentage, you know, but I was like, no, I'm going to do this together. And we've been doing this, tried and tested, failed, tried again for the last 5 years. And we've been sustaining and growing our business. And this is what we're doing with business owners, how to incorporate the law of giving into your business model so that it comes as the more you become richer, the more your business grows, someone else also benefits, whether it's the environment, whether it's to eliminate poverty, whether it's to develop people. Right. So this is where the law of giving can actually grow your business.
Mershita doesn't have a little business. Like, let's just get that clear. She has an enormous business. Like, for a woman in Kuala Lumpur, what she has built is just incredible. And Mershita, if you want to, you know, let us know just what you've built and, you know, the worth that you've accumulated within it, you're welcome to go ahead, because I think it would be very inspiring to a lot of these women.
All right. So right now, this is actually my new project, and I expedited this project because of COVID-19, right? It's to connect conscious businesses around the world to do business with each other, to refer business with each other, get paid for referring business to each other, and also do good at the same time, right? So we have a platform. It is an online as well as an offline platform. So right now it is more online, because offline is totally out.
Yeah.
yeah. So it's an online platform where you can get on, you get coached on earning your next 5 to 20K within the business or more, depending on where you are in your business. But most importantly is to get more visibility for your do good within the business, and to be able to connect with people around the globe, to, you know, do good together, to grow in your visibility together, to grow your incomes together, to have joint ventures. So,
if I'm remembering correctly, so when people use your app, they get credits for doing good things.
Good. Yes. Yes. We're incorporating that. Yes. Yes, yes. We're incorporating that into the system right now, as how many credits, like helping an elderly person cross the street. I did that. I got a picture. So we want to celebrate doing good, you know. It's just that there's been a lot of negativity about people doing good, and then shaming them and saying, oh, you shouldn't do this. Why not show good things and just celebrate, have fun with it.
It doesn't when you hear about people doing good things and seeing people doing good things, and it feels good.
Yeah, it feels exactly. Good. It feels
connecting
good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Let's do more good news instead of bad news on TV. And, you know, there are actually more good news. Yeah, but it's like.
I think we all need good news right about now. So, hey, Kelly. Hi, Kimberly. Hi, Irene. Some more people have joined. Mershita, if you were kind of to give people some, just break it down to some steps of how they can start growing their business using the law of giving, what would you kind of break that down to? And sort
okay.
of survival strategy?
All right. First of all, thanks, Holly. First of all, I would like you to think of your why first, right? And number two is how to activate that law of giving. First, you must be very grateful for what you have already, and in your business, what do you already have? You don't have to get new things that you don't need. How I work with my clients is I see what are their past experience, what are the things that you have done before that you have managed to overcome. Those things is a knowledge or an experience that people are willing to buy and learn from you because you have done it, right? What do you already have lying around in your house that could be of value, right? Mm-hmm. Already. So things like this that you're not moving. It's like a stuck energy, but it is still good. It's still in good condition. That is something that you can do. And then the other thing is who needs it? Who have been buying from you? Who are the people that in your past have been people who are like asking you for some help, asking you for something, asking you for advice, things like that, you know, and start noticing their background, start noticing their, what their needs are, what they normally look to you for help. This could be your target market, right? So this is the initial steps. And then get in touch with them. Call them, email them, be visible to them. You know, all of these things are so important for you to be in touch with people, because your target market is just waiting for you to talk to them. And they sometimes know you, sometimes they don't know you, or they've been watching you from afar. But when you call them, they're so grateful. They won't be like, oh, no, don't call me. That is not your target market. Your target market are people who really love you. They want to buy from you. They know what you stand for. And when you connect with them, you're talking to them, you're talking in their mindset, in their languaging, and you can help them come out of whatever challenges they are having or solve a certain problem. That is your business, right? So, and also think of how you can add value in your communities. Besides, you know, the people that you can earn money from, look at your surroundings. What are the challenges that people in your surrounding has? That is an issue. People complaining about something. People say, why can't this be resolved? Why can't this be done? See if there is some way where you can help through your business to change that problem. Maybe it's an environment. Maybe it's something that people are using a lot of, people are complaining a lot about the use of plastics and how it's destroying the environment. So maybe your product, you can say your product is actually organic and doing something good for the environment instead. Mm-hmm. It could be something about the poor. There are more people poorer in the world right now. And you look around in your neighborhoods, people who need jobs, people who have a certain kind of problems. So if you can do something to solve certain problems through your business, you know, that is a major selling point. People in your community says, look, this is a problem she can help solve through her business. And they love us. And she's always in front of us. And she's always connecting to us. That is where they resonate. They will buy from you. So all of those things, look around you, and you already have those. You are sitting on money. You're sitting on something that can be moving in your business that maybe you were not, it's static, you know? And that's what I realized back in 2006. I had this database. It was a new database. I had no idea it was there. And just moving that around, connecting people, offering what I already have, which at that time were connections who I knew. And I just, hooked up. And that's how my business grew. People started knowing me. People started knowing what I do. And they started supporting me. And that's how you can incorporate that, yeah, in your business.
Okay. That's incredible. So a lot of time we already have a lot of value to offer people. It's not just always about the money or the product or the service. Often it's just maybe who you know or who you can connect other people with. And then you can use that to grow your business, and you know, they're going to connect you with other people, and people are going to be interested in what services you have. And very, very interesting. So if any of you watching have any questions for Murshida, maybe about how you can position your product or service, and how you can ask for help within, you know, whatever realm of business that you're in, or maybe some ideas on who you can reach out to, please go ahead and put it in the comments. We'd be happy to answer those for you. But, and I love too what you say, Rashida, about getting visible. You know, you were emailing like 300 people. Like, you didn't stop. You didn't just email 5 people and not get out there. And now it's, you know, we still have email, but I'm really all about the video. Get yourselves on video, you guys. People, you know, that's just like being the next best thing to being face to face with them. But they can see who you are. They can see how you hold yourself and how you carry yourself and your energy, and really connect with you that way. But if you're not getting on video, you're not allowing people to have the opportunity to do that. And, you know, chances are somebody watching, if you're getting out there consistently and promoting yourself on your video, somebody watching is gonna see, you know, what you have, and they're going to want to connect with you just as much as you want to connect with them. So doing that consistently is
very important to be visible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you are really doing some amazing things in your community right now. Rashida, you're kind of like an angel of Kuala Lumpur. Not only do you have this very busy, successful business, and you're creating a new business. And I know you have your weekly meetup, women leadership group. Yeah. On top of that, because you just have so much time on your hands
now,
you're going out into the community and gathering food for people that have lost their jobs due to this pandemic that's happening right now.
Exactly. And you know what? I find that I can do this a lot faster right now than before, because before I used to shop myself with a big trolley, and, you know, I used to do everything, from getting the food and putting it in plastic bags and distributing and all that. So now what I realized, the more effective way is to actually have a team, right? To gather people in a certain location, and I appoint a leader. And just using this, I staying at home, and I found that I actually created more impact. And I didn't have to leave the house and distribute in my car and all that. No, I just use my phone, and people are willing to help. There are people out there looking for ways to give. So it is about finding your team, finding your people. Yeah, and you can do it with this. Yeah, so that's why I find, like, hey, nowadays it's, you know, we can do a lot more things with a phone.
Amazing. Yeah. So if people want to find your app so they can go on and connect with other businesses all over the world, it's international, right? Where would they find out about it? Do they just download it, or from the app store?
Yeah, they download it. Right now we're working on putting it up on the Play Store. It is available on Play Store also. So, but we need to advise you, because it is a joint venture app as well, and a business listing app where, you know, your business, your name, and we don't want you to download and then people refer business to other people, because if you refer somebody, you should get paid for that one. So you have to be registered. Yeah. And we'd like to know about your business as well, whether you're a conscious business.
Right. Because we want to have a good authentic felt.
Exactly. So send me on Messenger. You're on Facebook. You can just message me and say you're interested to know. I'll show you how to download the app, and just tell me that, you know, how do you get to know us? And we know you came from Holly. So, you know, that's how it works. Yeah. That's how we move our network as well. So we'll know, and we'll reward the people whenever there's any business transactions. We'll reward the people who, you know, referred the business.
Right. Oh, wow. Well, thank you so much for sharing your very fascinating story with us. I mean, going from 50 cents to $5,000 in 2 weeks, just using a database and, you know, flying by the seat of your pants. that's pretty amazing.
Crazy.
So if you had one piece of advice to give to any of our listeners today who maybe are, you know, maybe they've lost a job, or maybe their business isn't doing so well right now because of the whole pandemic situation. You've been through it, you've done it, you created success out of a really not such a successful a story. You turned it all around. What is the one sort of piece of golden advice that you would advise anyone going through that right now?
Okay. This is the same advice I give myself, and I remind myself, and sometimes my husband also is the one who reminds me. Who can we help? It shifts out the whole mindset. Yeah, who can we help? Who can we help right now? And whenever I'm feeling down, whenever I'm feeling like a challenge or something, I look out for someone who needs my help. One thing, it feels like, you know, I'm worthy. It puts me in the state like, oh, I'm worthy. I am able to help. So I'm not a victim. I'm always,
Yeah, as women, that's just, we want to help. But, yeah. You know, doing it in this way is maybe kind of a new spin for us. So that's a really good point.
Yeah. So when we can help, and always always notice this, yeah, whenever you give something, notice how you feel, whether you're happy with it and all that. You give something, even small things, something that you can, even the good words, you know. Okay, I'm just, if you allow me a little bit of time, just happened about a few days ago. I've got one refugee calling me, and she said, I'm so embarrassed. I said, what's going on? She said, I know, you know, you want us to be, you know, very independent and all that, but she's really stuck with rent. She can't pay rent, you know. And then she said, I'm just finding a way. And she's trying to ask for help from people, and a lot of people are not answering her calls. So I told her, you know, at that time I was like, I didn't say, okay, here's the rent money. No. So I told her, you go and pray, and then let's ask your landlord for another week of extension. Let's all see what we all can do. And I said, don't stop helping people. And but she says, yes, I know a lot of poor people in my community. I will help them, you know, either helping them, you know, get to their beds if they're invalid or whatever. So she does a lot of good work. So within 5 days, and today I've got somebody who told me, Mushida, I've got some money. Who do you need in your community who really needs some, you know, she's got a donation to give. And I said, yeah, I was thinking of that person who just asked me for the rent money. And I gave her a call. I said, look, I got some money. I'm going to transfer it to your bank account. And she was like, oh my God, I did everything you told me. I helped people. I pray to God. And, you know, she said, this is an amazing thing that happened. So it is, you know, sometimes you feel like you're stuck somewhere, but never stop praying. Always think of something that you can help others with. Like for her, she's always helping this refugee, and the money came in other forms. And there was a reason why she called me to ask for help, because somebody called and said, hey, you know anybody who needs some money? I've got money for, you know, during Ramadan they want to donate some money. And I'm like, I'm thinking, this is the amount that she needs to pay her rent. So I said, this money is going to go to her.
So that's where both sides work. So the one lady made herself visible and asked for help, and the other lady made herself visible and said, who can I help? How can I help?
Yeah, exactly.
And the two teams came together, and there was some success. So
when you have that giving nature, just think of something that you can give, that puts you in a different energy altogether. And never forget to also receive, because energy blocks also happen when you don't receive. So women, I notice, also have sometimes challenges of receiving. So just receive. Just receive. So when you give, you see something. So
just receive.
Yeah. Give and receive. That's the law. That is the law. That is where the energy, money flows. Yeah.
Oh, that's an amazing story. Well, thank you so much for sharing that with us. I know I will be approaching things differently from now on, and you know, more focused on how can I help? What can I give? And really maybe digging through my database, seeing what kind of value I have there as well. So that's really great advice. Thank you so much for joining us, Mushida. And if anybody has questions for Mushida or wants to connect with her or find out more about the work she's doing, and she's got a lot of things going on. She also has a women's meetup group she runs once a week. She's got this international business connection project going on with her app. And she does business coaching. So, you know, she's been there, she's done it, she knows her stuff. And she knows how to get through these types of situations very well because she's been there and she's succeeded and pushed through it. So thank you. It was such a pleasure having you, such an honor having you all the way from Kuala Lumpur. Thank gosh for the internet. It's, and especially at a time like this, it's amazing. So
thank you so much, Holly, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to speak to your group.
Wonderful having you. And thank you everybody for joining us. It was wonderful having you too. And you know, if any of you have any questions, don't be shy. Put them in the comments. We can answer them later. This live will stay up in the group permanently. So if you ever want to come back and listen to it and maybe take some more notes and get some more inspiration, it will be here for you. So thank you so much, Rashida. It's evening here. So I'm going to say good night. I know it's morning there. So I hope you have a fantastic day ahead of you. And I know I'll be talking to you soon, so I'll look forward to that again. Okay,
thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.